For more latest news from the sports multiverse, please like, share and subscribe The Bridge and hit the bell icon to never miss a notification.
Hello everyone, we welcome you all to yet another episode of Oh My Olympics, our Olympic special podcast, where we talk about India's performances at the Tokyo Olympics and a little bit also about the other global stars who are involved. Today our discussion will be on badminton, where we have been partly disappointed, and while on the other hand PV Sindhu has been taking the Indian flag ahead on her own shoulders, right? So without much further ado, I'd like to introduce today's guests. First, we have Shlok Ramachandran, who is, of course, an Indian badminton player who has represented the country at multiple international tournaments. And he has won international titles also, 6 or 7, I think. And then we have Tanvi Lad also. So Tanvi Lad, who is also another Indian international badminton player who has also won titles. So hi, Shlok. Hi, Tanvi. How are you guys doing?
I am good. Thank you so much for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here.
Tanvi?
Yeah, me too. Thank you. Always a pleasure to do something for sport. So, looking forward.
Yeah. Bridge ne kafi articles pehle likhe hai, toh socha ki matlab we could give back something to Bridge on the other side now. So, getting even with Bridge now. So, yeah.
No, that's what Bridge does, no? We try and bring thoda sa... मतलब क्या बिलो लाइक स्पॉटलाइट में जो नहीं है उनको थोड़ा स्पॉटलाइट में लाने की वी डू दैट वी आर ब्रिजिंग द गैप
इन दैट आई एग्री ब्रिज हैज बीन डूइंग सम ग्रेट आर्टिकल्स फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम नाउ एंड या सो ब्रिज हैज ऑलवेज बीन वन ऑफ दोस यू नो हाउसेस व्हिच हैज प्रमोटेड यंगर शटलर्स एंड इज नॉट ओनली फोकसिंग ऑन द ए लिस्टर्स सो इट वाज अ नो ब्रेनर फॉर अस टू नॉट डू इट सो
Thank you so much for coming on board. So we'll start today's discussion. And just to start off, we are going to start with PV Sindhu because she has been amazing in the group rounds. She completely blanked her opponents. And then in the pre-quarters also, she just defeated Mia. And now she's in the quarters. So just to, you know, have a brief look, what do you think are her chances of winning a medal or ensuring a podium finish? I'll start with Shlok because I introduced him first and then we'll come to Tanvi.
Yeah, this is Tanvi's expertise of events, but I mean, she's looking into the zone. She feels like, it feels like she belongs here now. At Rio, she was still finding her feet and it was like a surprise.
Yeah.
But here, with all the expectations, all the hopes, you know, she's played extremely well. I knew she wouldn't have any issue with the Israeli girl, Senia. But I thought Changeni could be a little tricky. But again, extremely thorough performance. The first game was absolutely, she blanked Changeni. Second set, Changeni, you know, changed her tactics, tried to, you know, improve the pace of her match. But Sindhu was up for it. Again, today I thought it would be a little more close against Mia Blichfeldt of Denmark. You know, Danish players generally play well in the knockout rounds and, you know, they get the best out of their game at the biggest events. And she has beaten Sindhu earlier this year, but I never felt there was a moment where Sindhu was going to lose. Always in complete command. Not letting the pressure come to herself. Mia is one of those opponents who likes to get into the head of the opponent in a lot of you know, she rants here and there, plays a lot of mind games, but Sindhu was just like a rock on the court. And I'm expecting yet another podium finish from Sindhu, at least at a bare minimum. With the way she's playing, I do feel that she's going to beat Yamaguchi Akane. If Yamaguchi Akane reaches the quarterfinals, she's currently leading. So I'm assuming it's going to be Yamaguchi Sindhu with another thriller in the quarterfinals. Hopefully a thriller which Sindhu wins and not gives us heart attacks. But yeah.
Absolutely. I'm also thinking of the same way. Tanvi, I'll come to you because you have played against these opponents and you have been in this field. So what do you think are the realistic chances of, you know, Sindhu making it to the semifinals and then going further and then probably winning a bronze or maybe going to the final also, beating Taizu maybe in her potential opponent in the semis. and going to the finals and trying to achieve that gold medal that she couldn't win in 2016?
Yeah, so I think coming into this tournament itself, we've seen PV Sindhu practice not to make it to the knockout rounds or not to have a good Olympics, but to actually win a medal and win a gold. With Carolina being out of the picture, I think her coach Park and with the whole team at Suchitra and at the Gopichand Academy, she has really studied each opponent, something that I've seen at close quarters even Saina do before Rio, which she unfortunately didn't end up playing, but like every opponent was studied, training, the rally construction in practice, the routines were all simulated according to every opponent, and that's very visible because from round one in the knockout stages, of course, with Senia, Poli Karpova, there was not much opposition, but with the Hong Kong Cheung, we saw, like Shlok said, Cheung has this jump smash, she has a couple of tricky shots here and there, but Sindhu was just on it from point one, she just steamrolled her. We've seen a little bit of skill work that Sindhu has worked on, different strokes from different angles, a lot of new strokes, which are very evident. And in today's match with Mia, I think both are very attacking players and like to be very proactive. But the way Sindhu was dominating the net and also her overhead, those down the line smashes, she just didn't give. She outplayed Mia at her own game.
Yeah.
So the second game, Mia was absolutely frustrated and went down, a negative spiral. So I think we've seen glimpses of every aspect, be it the rally aspect, the skill aspect, or the attacking part of Sindhu. And against Yamaguchi, of course, it's going to be putting all of this together because it's going to be a marathon match, long rallies in Japan with a home crowd. So I think that's going to be a test. It may go to three games is my gut feel. But I don't expect anything short of a podium finish, possibly even a gold from Sindhu, the way she's going and the form she's displaying.
Yeah.
I think she's risen to the occasion.
Yeah.
Tanvi, speaking on, strokes, and do you also feel that her backhand has improved more than what she was playing? I feel the variation she's being able to put on those backhand shots from the baseline is giving her that time sometimes when she's tired to just hold back because she's generating the same kind of quality. I think that could be very crucial by playing Yamaguchi because at times you will have to conserve your energy because of the long rallies.
Yeah.
I think she's definitely worked on a lot of variation. We could also see in Xenia's match that after she was at a big lead, she was purposely going and trying out that backhand, and it's coming out so well. I think in the whole tournament in the women's singles, I think she's hitting the backhand as good as Taizu, who's actually one of the best backhand players, irrespective men's or women's. So yeah, that is one aspect which I saw has improved a lot. And I think, credit to Park Tae-sung, who's doing a phenomenal job with him.
I mean Sindhu has seems like she has added new weapons to her game, right, under Park. And she has, I also like how she's approaching the net and she's putting the pressure on the opponents, leaving them scrambling, right? So Tanvi, what do you think? And when you're up against someone like Yamaguchi, who won't give up, who won't leave an inch of space, right, who will return everything you throw at her. So, how does that factor in when it comes to the improvements that Sindhu has made in a game? Like Shlok was saying, that her backhand and all. So, Tanvi, what do you think of that?
So, with Yamaguchi, if you play the rallies, that's her game. She is extremely agile and likes getting into the longer rallies. So, Sindhu has to, get into the match with a mentality that, yes, this is going to be a marathon match. I need to be well-rested, well-fueled. But having added this backhand, having added a couple of late strokes, which we're seeing, that's a very good way. Like when, obviously there are going to be times in the match where you dominate and when you are feeling physically good. And then there are times when you are tiring where you need to, just slow down the pace of the game. And having these strokes is going to help her. Because especially with Sindhu, like opponents tend to pin her to the over the head, which is also her strong point. But then her strokes become predictable. Like she plays that cross court drop from the overhead, 9 out of 10 times. Now that she has added a backhand, she can, you know, if she's tiring, just turn and clear it out, or, you know, play in, you know, some of those neutralizing shots, which will help her, you know, recover, get back and keep the rallies going without really expending too much energy in being aggressive and attacking.
Yeah.
So this balance that we saw even Srikanth developing in his game, to balance out the attack, I think Sindhu is kind of going down that same road, and that's what's giving her time to, use her attack sparingly.
Yeah, in badminton context, developing those neutral strokes. I think that is the key word which has been worked. Neutral strokes. I think she's doing really well in the neutral strokes, and against Yamaguchi, those neutral strokes are going to be extremely handy. Because one of the things Yamaguchi does is that because she retrieves and retrieves, and sometimes she'll take strokes which are almost unretrievable, psychologically it puts an impact on the opponent. But I think, they both know each other's game from the palm of their hands. So I think it's again, wahi baat hoti hai. Olympic, if you want to win an Olympic gold medal, wo sari kainat judni hai. Ek ek karke wo puzzles aise judne hai. So, you know, we're hoping that, you know, all the puzzles, all the stars align. But it's looking good so far for Sindhu.
Right. Talking about Yamaguchi, she will be, as Tanvi mentioned, she will be playing at her home, not in front of the crowd because there is no fans allowed, but she'll be playing at her home in Japan. And there are a lot of expectations also from the local people of Japan, right? That she will go on and maybe win a medal. So, and when she's coming up against Sindhu, who everyone knows is a big tournament player, who shows up at every big tournament, be it the World Championships, be it the World Tour Finals, be it the Olympics. So, what kind of pressure should she feel? Will she be like, okay, Sindhu is here. I have played against her, I have lost against her, I have also won against her, but I've also lost against her more than a few times. So, and she is a big tournament player. She is an Olympic already silver medalist. And I'm playing at home. I'm carrying the expectations of all our countrymen. So, will that pressure affect Yamaguchi to a certain extent? Shlok, what do you feel?
I think Yamaguchi has gone a little bit under the radar, considering Okuhara has been in the spotlight for a while. Yamaguchi and Okuhara have always had that tussle of being the Japanese number one, but Okuhara, if you look at the past year, has taken away that number one position in the Japanese team. So I think even in terms of the Japanese media have not hyped up Yamaguchi a lot. Again, it is a home it is home advantage, but it is not home advantage. You don't have the crowd, so it's basically like playing at any other stadium. Just the fact that the Japanese team would have practiced a little bit more, that's about it. There's no crowd, so the drift won't affect a lot. I think more than Yamaguchi, I think the pressure will be on Sindhu. But again, she's been at this level for what, almost like 6 years now. She's been carrying that, and you saw the way she played at the Worlds in Switzerland. So I don't think pressure is a big point for Sindhu now. I think athletes at that level get equipped to it. And we are talking about, the top one percentile of the athletes over here. And Sindhu falls in that bracket.
Yeah, but then Momota losing out, why was that? Maybe it was because of the pressure, right? Because from the last 2-3 years, he has been projected as he will be the Olympic champion. He has won every tournament, more or less. He was almost invincible, right?
See, no, that's different, because here Sindhu is not winning every tournament because the women's singles field is so open.
Yeah, true.
Like nobody is winning 3-3 tournaments, 4-4 tournaments in a row. So that field is extremely open in women's singles. But whereas if you look at men's singles, almost 7 out of 10 titles have been won by Momota.
Exactly, yeah.
So more than the crowd pressure, the pressure on yourself that you have to go and perform. It's similar with Kevin Sanjaya and Gideon Fernandes. They lost today in the quarterfinals to Aaron Chia and Su Yik. Yeah. Again, everybody expecting them and they expecting themselves, and that pressure that, this is the world event. I've been winning Super Series, but, you know, winning a Worlds or winning
Olympics
is a different thing. So I think more than the pressure of the media or the country is the pressure you put on yourself. And with Momota and Kevin, it's been a landslide with them. If you look at the last three years, look at the number of tournaments they've won. It's crazy. Also, considering it's not the normal sporting year.
Yeah, true. True.
Momota hasn't played a lot of world badminton. Kevin couldn't play the All England. So again, it is a very tricky situation. That is why I feel one of the reasons why Momota maybe lost was because the fact that he didn't play a lot of tournaments this year. Kwang Hee-ho played a little bit more. COVID, he also had that accident even last year after COVID. Yeah. He decided not to travel to Thailand and all of that happened. So he also had a plastic surgery and
On his nose, right?
Plastic surgery
on his nose.
His nose after the crash also. I think part of Momota losing was also lack of match practice. But again, at that one, we are talking about top one percentile, right?
Yeah.
I think Momota would be extremely disappointed, especially considering his quota now.
Yeah.
And and seeing that, he's possibly given Kwang Hee-ho a shot at playing the semifinals, after Lee Hyun Il, somebody who could play from South Korea to play the semifinals. So, I mean, hard luck to Momota, but I think you can't say anything more than that. It's just the pressure you have on yourself, apart from the regular pressure. So, coming back to Sindhu on this, I think it because it's an open field, I would still say that Sindhu is a little more equipped. And again, world champion, right?
Yeah.
You have that at the back. And again, knows how to get an Olympic medal. She's done it in the past. None of the other players have done... Yeah. I have played Olympic final before.
Yeah.
Sindhu has played one. So that experience. She's moving into that part of her career where she's not the young gun anymore. She's starting to become an experienced player now.
Tanvi, I'll come to you. Why I was talking about this pressure situation is because it's not a normal year, as Shlok mentioned, right? And leaving badminton also, in other sports also, we saw the Simone Biles episode, right? Where she had that mental fallout and she just withdrew herself, right? So, all these things and this pressure, like this mental pressure, how do you deal with it as an athlete? I get it, you're the top one percentile and you have to get used to it. People are expecting you to perform under all kinds of pressure. But then, we saw Osaka incident also during the French Open. And now Simone Biles. So, how has this factor of mental pressure come into the sport world recently? Because is it because of the entire COVID situation? Is it because of the expectations? What do you think, Tanvi?
So, mental pressure has been associated with professional sport since the longest time, more so at an event like the Olympics.
It was never spoken of previously, right? No one used to come up and talk about it. Now they're talking about it. Yeah.
Yeah. Within the sporting circles, the concept of sport psychology has existed for that reason.
Yeah.
But now it's become more of a, like a hashtag, you can say, because people are coming, they're becoming more vocal. They are not hesitating to walk up to the coach and say that, there's so-and-so going on in my mind, or I'm feeling the pressure, I'm feeling the nerves, which is what Simone Biles did. I mean, she's come under so much criticism from her country because being a woman of color, and B, when the country is actually expecting you to, after her performance in Rio, they were expecting her to, actually lead the US gymnastics team to a medal haul, and then to actually pull out because she was feeling the nerves to the extent that she couldn't compete. But that is, I think it all boils down. You can't predict what will happen on the day, and when, the event can just overwhelm you. Especially when you haven't competed for very long, you've been out of competition, the whole COVID situation where there's lack of clarity, is the Olympics happening, it's suddenly postponed by a year, then again, a couple of days before you've landed at the village, and then again, there are talks, rumors that the Olympics may be called off because cases in... So, there is so much uncertainty as an athlete, we plan to the T. We want to peak at an event, plan 4 years.
Yeah, it's Olympics is a 4 year cycle, right? So you plan to peak at in 2020 and then it suddenly gets postponed. Yeah.
Correct. There's money riding on it. There's personal decisions riding on it. There's so much that goes on in an athlete's mind, because he's not doing it for fun. He's doing it as a profession, and his life depends on it. His finances depend on it. His country is expecting him. So expectations are there. But it all boils down to training. I think that's one thing that if you notice, the ones who have consistently, or even those who have medaled, say, at their third Olympics or their fourth Olympics, that's when they've actually learned to get the better of their nerves. Yeah. So mental training and all these techniques, mental techniques that they use, are something that have to be, I think, emphasized a lot more. Indians as a nation are quite prone to being anxious. They're not mentally the strongest. So that is a big area that I think as Indians we can work on, as a culture we can work on. But having said that, it's very normal to feel the nerves and to, but like we train our bodies, and that usually does translate to a certain degree. It does make you mentally strong. But a concerted effort to work on your mind, or have a person who is like on your support staff there to take care of whatever is happening mentally, guide you through that perfect week that you're looking for at the Olympics. That is something that probably needs to, and I'm sure it's going to be the way ahead, because you look at any sport.
Yeah.
You look at cricket, you look at now gymnastics. We saw the Naomi Osaka incident. It's becoming a trend.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be the way forward.
Coming back to Sindhu, we have already talked about the Yamaguchi clash, right? But if she gets over the Yamaguchi clash, if she beats her, then the next step is Tai Zuing, who is probably the most deceptive player on the circuit. As for me, I don't know a lot of badminton, but from what I see, I feel that her deceptions are just next level. Right? Like, no one can understand if she's hitting a drop shot or she's hitting a smash. She can just turn it around like that. And her backhand, of course, you mentioned, is very strong. So when coming up against Tai Zu, what do you think will be Sindhu's tactics? I'll start with Tanvi and then I'll come to Shlok on this one.
So with Tai Zu, I think you need to go in with three plans, because she has the ability to switch her game around. She's very unpredictable with her stroke selection as well. Sindhu will have to judge and keep, you know, switching things around. Like I mentioned, Sindhu now has plans ABC in her armory. So whether she needs to be patient, whether she needs to, you know, be a little deceptive or take initiative, that is something that she needs to sense as per the situation. And it's going to boil down to that, playing the right stroke at the right time, using the right tactic at the right time. But having said that, I think Tai Zu has, you know, that's one title she hasn't won in her career. So she is going to be coming in with that on her mind. So Sindhu should look at capitalizing, because, you know, if you look at the Olympics, Sindhu has more experience. They've always played close matches. So mentally, I think Sindhu has a bit of an advantage.
Shloka, what are your thoughts on the Tai Zu clash?
Yeah, I think firstly, we shouldn't discount Rachnok. I think Rachnok is playing Tai Zu Ying in the quarterfinals. Okay. I mean, Rachnok, world champion, you know, has been, you know, in the circuit forever, and she's just what, 25, still 25. I don't think she ages. But I think with Tai Zu, you know, she has the ability to break patterns and, you know, stop somebody, you know, from going through the motions. But again, you know, with Sindhu, with her reach, has always, you know, liked playing with her. Saina has struggled playing with Tai Zu, but Sindhu hasn't struggled that much, because I think her reach on court helps her. So even when her movements are broken, she somehow finds the way to come back. And now with the neutral strokes, with all of this which she's added, I think she's prepared. I think she's prepared for every player. Like Tanvi said, there isn't a single player which Sindhu isn't prepared for. I think Park Tae-sung has made sure that he's played Sindhu against a variety of players from all the resources he's had. But again, on the day, it's going to boil down to execution. You know, you can plan and plan and plan, but ultimately, who has you know, who's a little more brave to execute that at the right time and, you know, go for her shots. I think, you know, to win an Olympic semifinal, you need that bravery. And you saw Sindhu when she played Wang Yihan at Rio. she was brave, you know, she was brave for going for a shot because again, nothing to lose, you know. You know, she's here as a 21-year-old playing the semifinals, but again, can she do it again with that pressure? I do think she can. It's all about execution because the plan is set. She knows what she needs to be done. I think, but it's all boils down to execution now.
Just one last point that I had on Sindhu is that, you know, last she has always had Gopi sir by her side, right? She's always had Gopi Chand at her corner, who has been there at the Olympics, at the World Championships. And this is probably the first big tournament where Gopi sir is not there. She has a new coach who has definitely improved her. We have seen that already. But is that going to play on her mind somewhere that, or she will just forget on the court, right? It's okay. Like, it will be her game. So I just want to get your thoughts on it. Like, is Gopi sir's absence going to affect in any way?
I don't think it will affect her with the way she's playing. She's won tournaments also with, sometimes somebody else being on that coach's chair. But again, I mean, it could not, but I personally do believe that she's, she's at that level where, she even while if she would have spoken to, Gopi sir before the match, I think it's good enough now. And maybe she's prepared for the fact that, Gopi cannot travel all the way this time. And she's prepared for Park Tae-sung being there in her corner. So I do not think personally it will affect her. But again, it's a very subjective question.
Yeah.
Only Sindhu can answer that question. But from an athlete's point of view, you are used to, different coaches sitting for your matches.
Okay. Tanvi, do you agree with Shlok here?
Yeah, pretty much. I think, probably as a younger athlete, it would have affected her. And I think someone like maybe a Carolina, if you take, her coach away, if you tell Fernando Rivas to not sit for her matches in the Olympics, it will affect her because she is like, it's like a father-daughter relationship there. So I think early on when Park started traveling, we probably felt that, Gopi's absence is showing its effect mentally on Sindhu, even her game. She was floundering in her defense. But the way she's prepared for this, I think they've kind of developed that bond. Park has spent a lot of time with Sindhu and that makes the difference. We saw Sindhu spend a lot of time with Kim before the World Champs. And, it became like a thick bond. They knew what each other were thinking. When Park says something, now we see Sindhu execute it immediately. So as long as that has been developed and they've trained in a specific way, I think it should be fine, as long as that connect is there between the coach who's sitting at the back and Sindhu's able to execute the plans correctly. Yeah. That's at the end of the day what matters. Like Shlok said, I think a conversation with Gopi even to just say that, I have your back and just go out there and play freely. Even that much is probably enough for Sindhu at this point of time because her homework is all done. It's now mentally believing and actually doing the job.
Yeah.
Experience is all. She's an experienced campaigner now. Like Tanvi said, as a youngster, maybe yes, but now not at the level she is right now. I don't think it'll be an issue.
True. I think that sums it up probably. So now we'll move on to Satvik and Chirag, who are probably the most, gutted right now. Because as fans, we are gutted sitting in India and we can't even begin to imagine what they are going through. They gave their best. They beat the world number threes, right? Stretching that match, last game went to 27-25. And then they couldn't obviously overcome the minions because, the minions are the world's best on their day. And again, in the third match, even before entering the third match, they knew they were out. So, and yet they did not let it show on their performance. They won the third match in straight sets, right? So, how right now, what do you think is Satvik and Chirag is going through? Shlok?
And yeah, I spoke to them yesterday and they're absolutely gutted. I've been teammates with both of them for the longest of times. Chirag has been my schoolmate. Satvik and I were roommates back at the national camp and I could see it when I was speaking to them that, they are absolutely gutted. They both couldn't sleep. And, Satvik is one of those people who, irrespective of winning and losing a match, when he goes to sleep, he has no regrets and he just like sleeps. But he said that, bhaiya, two out of three jeeta, phir bhi quarterfinal nahi pahunch paya. Aur kya karu? I'm having too many regrets, he's telling. And that is so unsattvic, like. And I had no words to tell him. Said his brother is getting married in a couple of weeks' time. I just said that, you know, your time will come. This is not the end. You will obviously work through this and, life will come to a cycle again.
Yeah.
It'll fall in the right circle. But, only they know how they feel. Or somebody who's lost that birth will understand that feeling, how it is. But again, credit to them. Before and to put in that performance against Ben Lane and Sean Wendy wasn't easy.
Exactly.
I don't know from where they found that motivation, but that just shows how far they've come as a pair and how far they've come up as individuals. Yeah. Remember, Sattvic is only in his early 20s.
Yeah. He's
very young. He's only 23, 24.
Yeah.
Yeah. They are going to be the mainstay of Indian doubles for the next 6 years at least. They are going to play Paris, hopefully, fingers crossed, and LA if not to. But again, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. They've been absolutely phenomenal. I mean, to keep that composure against Liang and Chin Li Wang, remember, they haven't lost a single match in the whole year. Yeah. 19-16 down, coming back from that, winning. But then ultimately, you have to give Chin Li Wang and Liang that due credit also. They had their back to the walls. They had to beat world number ones.
Yeah, true.
And they did it.
Yeah.
So I think in terms of that, they have Chirag and Sattvic have nothing to be, fear to have any regret about. Yes, maybe they could have, played a little better against Kevin. But I don't know what happened to Kevin Sanjaya after he played Chirag Sattvic. He lost that and he also lost in straight games today to Aaron Chia and Su Wu Yik.
Yes.
So again, that pressure we are talking about on yourself. But it'll just get better on for Chirag and Sattvic from here. I hope they find them a good coach because Bo's contract has got over with the Sports Authority of India and BI. They need a good coach and they've always been surrounded by good coaches. They've had Kim Tanher.
Definitely.
Gopi sir has always been there. And then they had Bo and their 6 months preparation. But the next coach is going to be a very key person to like plan the next 4 years. Again, it's not 4 years away, it's only 4 years away. So you start backdating from now. Ideally, somebody who could think long term and be till the next Olympics has to be then. It has to be a good, top quality foreign coach. I don't think there is anybody who can, at that level right now who can take them to the next level in India. It has to be somebody like a Matthias Bo or a Rexy Menaki or a Ricky Subhajia, Joachim Fischer-Nelson, somebody. I do hope that, BI and Sai, I'm sure they are already in their works of getting the Indian doubles continent a new head coach. But again, they were just splendid. And I think the whole of India is proud of them and they couldn't have done anything better. Just their luck. I was Kainat nahi judi. Groups, you start from the group itself. Groupie matlab group of death mila. And then your schedule also is as such that you're playing Ben Lane, Sean Mendy right at the end. Yeah. It's not that. So it just didn't click this time. All they can do is next time, try to get into the top eight and get a better group. And I do feel that by the time they are going, it's just a matter of time that they are going to get into the top eight.
Yeah, yeah.
The only pair I thought they could lose was Kevin Sanjaya and Gideon. It's a bit of a mental block, but I don't think any other pair they would have had issues. If you look at who's playing the semi-finals now, Liu Yuchen and Liu Junhui, they've beaten. Kamura Sonoda lost. So, Mohamed Ehsan and Hendra Setevan, they've beaten them.
Yeah.
Aaron Chia, Su Wu Yik, they haven't played a lot.
Yeah.
But all of them, they've beaten them, right? It's not that they haven't beaten them. So, it's just a matter of time. Commonwealth and Asian Games next year. Expecting medals both the tournaments from there, touchwood.
Yeah. Like, I remember I spoke to Chirag in 2018 and also Sattvic just before the India Open in 2018, right? There was an event at the hotel Prakash Padukone's lifetime achievement ceremony, right? There I spoke to them, and both of them, they were at that time, they were just up and coming. They had not even won any major titles, right? They had not won their first Thailand Open or anything. And yet they had that confidence. Chirag told me, I think we have a chance of winning a medal in Tokyo. Yeah, that is what Chirag told me. And when they lost, I went back to that interview and I was reading that interview. And I felt really, really bad, right? So, and as Shlok mentioned, that only they can say what they went through. They are going through right now. But as an athlete, how do you pick yourself up from this? That you have given your all, you have probably done everything that you could, and then you just lost out because of luck. And if luck wasn't a factor, maybe you could have gone that whole way and won a medal. Maybe even an Olympic silver, because the road right now, the pathway is right now is clear. So as an athlete, what do you tell yourself that Paris 2024 is, we will always have another Olympic something? What do you tell yourself to, you know, motivate yourself and keep yourself in the right frame of mind, Tanvi?
I think once you hit rock bottom, which they've reached right now, it's actually, as an athlete, it's not a bad space to be in, because you know that I've put in the hours, I've done my best, I've come to a big stage like the Olympics, and I've actually done well. Now, if you know things didn't fall into place, and you know, it was purely that 1% luck factor which played a role in me getting a bad group, the scheduling being all over the place, and then me playing one bad match and being thrown out. So it literally boiled down to bad luck. So I think nothing to lose. In fact, it's a very good space to be in. Now, after taking some time off, and maybe, you know, like if Satwik's brother's getting married, you know, on the personal front, you just spend some time doing other things and then get back to routine. There's nothing special that they need to do. They've played at the level. And, you know, it's just a matter of time when it's meant to be. The same things that have probably been factors that have, you know, ousted them will actually come together. Like, you know, I mean, I'm touch wood, but in Sindhu's case, we are seeing those very factors come together in a positive way. So, you know, the way she has moved, progressed, you can actually see that the very fact, you know, these same factors are actually working in her favor. So if it's meant to be, everything will fall into place. They will get a better group. They will win the matches that they are supposed to win. And things will work in their favor. So I think it's just a matter of time. As an athlete, they just need to come back to India with their heads held high. No overthinking needed. You just need, you know, the next 4 years, a good person, like Shlok said, behind them to have their back, guide them along the way. And I think it's just a matter of time before we see the medals come in.
Yeah, I think hopefully.
Mentally so strong, right? I mean, yeah. It is just not skill what has made them play at this level.
And they have improved like massively from when they started. They were initially in the juniors, they were not paired together, right? They were playing with Dhruv, they were playing with other people. And then suddenly they were paired together. And then they started playing together, complemented each other and improved so much over the last 1-2 years. Like in 2018, 2019, they hadn't entered world top 10. And then they breached that thing in 2019 endish, right? 2019 endish, 2020, around that time, they reached world number 7. So their progression has been there. But then again, as an athlete, when you say this time the Olympics is not 4 years, this time the next Olympics is just 3 years away. So when you're at the Olympics again next year, and you are in the group, will these things play at the back of their mind? That last time at Olympics, we had done this and yet we had not been able to go further because of the luck factor. So this time we need to put, you know, all our effort and win all our group matches. Will that be some kind of pressure on them, or how do you think that will play on them?
No, they'll play more major games, right? They'll play Commonwealth, they'll play Asian Games, they'll play more World Championships. Yeah. They'll get more experience. I don't think it'll be like a big issue. And, you know, going back, I think it was a vision from Kim Tan Her. I remember Kim Tan Her in 2016, you know, saying out loud in one of our group sessions that these both of them are going to play the Tokyo Olympics, are going to play well.
Yeah.
You know, it is no surprise with the progression, especially like me who's trained with them, is no surprise in the transition they've made. They've actually gone, you know, ahead of what Kim Tae and her planned. So you need somebody like his vision. That vision was there from 2016. कि 2016 में ये करेंगे, 17 में ये, 18, 19 and 20 में जाके they'll be there. So his vision
plan था, right?
His vision was by 2019 they should be you know, playing Super Series finals and by 2020 they'll peak. But they won the Super Series much before and Grand Prix gold much before.
Yeah.
So they went ahead and again, you know, especially Satwik. I've told this in like I think so many interviews. He falls into that that composure. Some people have that composure who never get phased away by, you know, pressure. He's one of those. You look at every time there's been a big match. I've hardly seen him lose at 20 all, 21 all. You look at Commonwealth Team Championship Finals.
He
won against Goh Liu Ying and Chen Peng Sung. World Championship Quarterfinals with Ashwini Ponappa. Yeah. Whenever it has mattered the most, he's delivered. Sudhirman Cups, Thomas Cups, every time that kid delivers. It is not that he doesn't. So that kid mentally is at a much higher level than what the athletes are at 25-26.
Okay.
And it is scary because he's only 20 and he's got 20. That mental composure.
Yeah. Yeah.
So imagine 4 years down the line when he's going to play more world championships, one more Asian Games, one more Commonwealth. What will his mental strength be like? And even after going through something like this, he's going to be, somebody who's going to take over. I don't know if he's going to play mixed also in the future, but he's going to be a mainstay for a while. I just hope that his body is well maintained and, you know, the federation invests in a good strength and conditioning coach and a good physiotherapist full time just for them. Because I think that is very important for both of them right now. We need to nurture them because they are potentially one of our... this Olympics has shown that they are potentially are one of our best shots at getting a world medal or an Asian medal or they've already have a CWG medal.
Fingers crossed.
If anything, this just adds to that. What more can we do them? Can we do for them? Yeah. Just to make sure that they get even better. And I think all in that top bracket now.
Yeah. Now, finally, coming to Sai Pranit's performance, right? He was the lone men's singles player in Tokyo. Kidambi missed out, unfortunately. Laksha also couldn't make it. So, and obviously, when there is only one representative, you hope that he will do well, at least reach the knockouts. Because, of course, when we were looking at the draw, when it came out, we were looking at probably a Momota face-off in the knockout. And okay, you don't expect him to probably beat Momota, but at least in the quarters, he should have gone. Is what, as badminton fans who follow the badminton calendar year-round, that's what we expect. That's the right we have. Like, he won the World Championship bronze. So, it is not that we have set expectations without any grounds, right? We have set expectations because of his performances. So, and then he suddenly, like, in the group matches, he lost both of those matches. Tanvi, what do you think of his game at the Tokyo Olympics? Why could he not perform?
So I think this 1 year break has kind of, he's not taken it too well. Having said that, the whole men's singles contingent, even we've seen Shrikant struggle with form post the pandemic.
Yeah.
Laksh was the only one, of course, much younger and inexperienced, but was the only one who was actually looking like he's coming into form. So I would have probably laid my bets on him for a Tokyo 2021 over Sai. Sai was in good shape, you know, in the qualification period, and had the Olympics happened on time, probably would have played a better Olympics. But this whole 1 year of uncertainty and
Lack of tournaments.
You know, Sai is not somebody even in training who can endure 12 weeks of training at a stretch. He needs that motivation of a tournament. He is a creative player. So if you're going to take away competition, he's going to lose motivation. He's going to feel that lack of... He's like an artist. You need to keep giving him an opportunity to express himself. And that match practice... not having that match practice has kind of hit him badly. mentally we saw Sai from the first round just not there on court. His body language was down. His he was clucking and looking like he has no control over why he's playing so badly. But having said that, I think so practice wise and fitness wise, we saw that he's put in the work. He had been putting in the sessions. He's looking a lot fitter. But like I said, he doesn't bank on that. He has to be in flow when he's playing. And that was clearly not there. So that form that he was looking for was missing. I'm sure that, having played at this level and he's feeling bad, he's come under a lot of criticism. He's going to take it to heart. And this may be a motivating factor now for him before the Commonwealth and Asian Games to actually pull up his socks and do something, change things around.
Yeah, he has looked like a shadow of himself, as we all saw. Shlok, what do you feel about his performance?
I think, I have always been a fan of Sai, and I really had high expectations of him because the fact that whenever at the biggest stage, he's always performed well. His Super Series final, first chance, got gold. GP gold, first time, got gold. World Championship saw that open quarter, got that bronze. Even like before the Olympics, when I was discussing with my friends, I placed Sai I think he can do a good job. But I just felt one that again, that short of match practice, hasn't played, a lot of world badminton in the past year. Again, it's no excuse. Again, very passive. Extremely passive. I thought he wasn't brave enough to take his chances. Zilberman was brave, as you said, you have to be in situations like this. It's very easy for me to obviously say that, you could have been brave, but I just felt with the quality he has, he could have been a little more, a little more positive, not maybe positive is not the right word, and not be reacting to every stroke, if that makes sense, setting the game or like pushing the pace yourself and making sure that you are the one who's taking initiative. I think initiative is the right word. I didn't feel there was enough initiative in his game. He led 8-4 in the first against Zilberman, and I think that was his best spell of the Olympics. That first 8 points against Zilberman, when he was 8-4, that was the only point where he was at his best, because he struggled against Mark also. You would expect him to beat Mark Kalyov. But the thing is that now that quarter has opened up completely.
Yeah.
Right? We're talking about Momota and Sai playing quarter and Enkalong also playing in that pre-quarter. Enkalong bhi gaya, Momota bhi gaya, Sai bhi gaya. Bacha kaun? Mark Kalyov, Kevin Corden and Kwang Hee-ho. The whole South Korean media possibly wouldn't have even known the fact that he's playing the Olympics. Out of nowhere, beats Momota. Here, Kevin Corden is playing the pre-quarter final. Mark Kalyov is playing there. Below, Toby Penty has beaten another World Championship bronze medalist, Kantafon. I mean, this Olympics is a different Olympics, first of all, right? It's not new. And somebody's going to take his chance. I think this could be Victor's Olympics with everything. Victor's or Anna's Olympics with everything falling through, especially in Victor's quarter. He has to possibly get through Shiyuki, who's going to be tricky.
They play the semi, they win.
Yeah, so Shiyuki and Victor played the quarterfinals. If they beat, Shiyuki plays Jonathan Christie and Victor plays Wang Zuwei. Yeah. You expect both of them to reach the semifinals, and their winner will play possibly Kwang Hee-ho and Mark Kalyov or Kevin Corden. If Kevin Corden makes the semifinal, that would be a story to remember, because Kevin Corden has done this in the past also. Like he once beat Chen Long out of nowhere, and he has this knack of sometimes coming and playing, but I don't know how long his body can survive. Again, he's in the 30s now. I'm expecting Kwang to continue or maybe Mark to play, but yeah, that Victor and Shiyuki, the everyone in that bottom quarter must be licking their lips right now. This is their chance, that if they just need to get through the quarters and they know that they've got a sure shot medal, and Sai must be ruining this. knowing Sai, he must be seeing this and he must be feeling extremely like disappointed about it. I think as an athlete, you know, you are the person who will feel most disappointed. I don't think there is anybody else who, you know, as long as we are disappointed, he's the one who's played. He knows what went wrong. But yeah, again, you go back to the drawing board. You start training again. You set new targets. You set new goals, and you get back again. You know, obviously, as an athlete, you know, I'm not going to put out any more criticism because I know how it feels sometimes to play at the highest level and lose. So yeah, I mean, I would still say to Sai that, you know, it's okay, chin up. You know, I know you're being trolled at social media, and you know, people, you know, there are tweets like, you know, hisab nikalo ki tops ne kitna paisa diya. I mean all of that, you know, I hope that he's blocked out all of that social media, and you know, goes back, fights through this, because yeah, he's quality. If there's anybody who says that Sai Praneeth is not you know, top tier quality, he or she doesn't know anything about badminton.
Exactly. He has a world championship bronze.
Yeah, world championship bronze, super series winner. Credit when due. Like,
yeah. He has been in the top 10 also. Come on.
Top 10. Yeah. Even if you look at the way he's dominated Indian badminton, the only player to win from the junior category to senior category, he's a national champion everywhere.
Yeah.
So I just think that, you know, he's going to go back to the drawing board, because I felt he was fit. It's not that he wasn't fit. It's not one of those tournaments where Sai has lost on fitness. He's just lost on maybe, you know, the whole Olympic thing getting bigger of him. But again, you know, big year next year, again, Commonwealth, Asian Games, again, same, go back to the drawing board, you know, and try to work your way back. He knows Lakshya Sen is right behind his, you know, spot. Srikanth is a rejuvenated. Srikanth is also coming for his spot. You know, all of them are coming. Sameer Verma will be back in the fray soon. So he'll have to get his socks up if he wants to at least make the team for these big games, because getting into the Indian men's singles team is not easy for these bilateral games.
Yeah.
I mean, knowing Sai, he would definitely, you know, be in the fray for next year too.
Yeah. So we are hitting.
I have a little bit of a different take on that.
Yeah.
I think it's going to take a while for Sai to come back mentally from this. A, because he's, you know, if it was fitness, it's very easy. You know, you put him on a cardio program or you put him on an SNC program and you get Sai fit. But here, it's a lot that he's going to have to work on mentally, breaking through all the negativity that he's going to be surrounded with. He's already surrounded by a lot. And as a person, we know that he is kind of emotional as a person. So tends to get affected by stuff that's going on around him. I think he will, and you know, with the added pressure that big games are coming up and, you know, all these men singles players at his neck, he's going to be in a tough space for the next 6 months for sure. But let's see what it brings out in him.
Yeah. So we are hitting the hour mark. So I'll bring this conversation to a close quickly, probably one or two more questions. My first question would be a very straightforward one-line answer that I would expect from you guys. Can PV Sindhu change that silver medal into a gold medal? Because fans will be asking that question when we stream this podcast. So just to get your thoughts, can Sindhu change her silver to gold?
Yeah, surely. 100%.
Yeah. And secondly, because when you look outside badminton also, overall, India has disappointed at the Olympics so far. Like we were expecting, but yeah, there were a lot of medal hopes, right? And then until now, we have only had one, Mirabai Chand. So looking forward, what do you think? How many medals can India end up with if you're following other sports as well?
I mean, my current hope is that I think only with Marie Kom maybe, and maybe Sindhu, like two more if we have like a very special Olympics.
Yeah. Hockey, I would maybe not a medal now that they've gotten to the quarters. I mean, you never know.
Yeah.
One more match and we have a medal. So maybe that extra.
Also, maybe in wrestling also, maybe, right? Vinesh Fogart. Yeah.
Vinesh Fogart, yes.
Yeah.
again with wrestling is so unpredictable, right? I mean, you've got Amit Pangal in boxing too.
Boxing is very unpredictable, right? Even the boxers don't know. Even
wrestling, you can't like jot down that. But I would still think that Mary Kom, the Indian hockey team, Amit Pangal is obviously world number one. But can he do it when it matters the most?
Okay. Thank you guys for being so patient and having this lovely discussion. I think this conversation went very well, where we discussed about Indian badminton and other sports also at the end, right at the end. I hope you also enjoyed this conversation. And thank you for coming. And we'll hope to get you here once PV Sindhu wins that medal.
Sure. Done. 100%.
Thank you.
Thank you.